This all starts with a budget LK5 Pro 3D printer to now this. It is a complete 3D printer overhaul and the print quality is as good as you can get. I will cover multiple upgrades and show you what you can expect from each of them. So without further ado, let's start with a simple question: why I decided to make these upgrades in the first place? Honestly, I wouldn't do it if the frame of a printer wasn't that good. It is the best part of this printer and it makes a perfect base to start on. Because if you have a wobbly and not rigid axis, ghosting results that you will get when pushing for high speeds will be disastrous, like on my old Mega S. The x-axis here is so bad that I get better results on the way heavier but way more rigid y-axis. So we have a structural rigid frame in all directions, or at least it is easy to attach to rods to increase it. So what's next? Let's start from the bottom, the y-axis linear rails instead of POM wheels. I covered this upgrade in more detail in one of my previous videos. Long story short, the heavier the bed and the higher speeds and accelerations, the more difference you will see in the reduced ghosting. Another significant benefit of the rails to take into account is that you could level the bed manually all with a probe and forget for a long time, as linear rails are so much more durable and don't need any adjustment. And if you have a bed of a flatness like a waving flag, having a bed mesh and no need to recalibrate it every print is worth it on its own. The wheels on y-axis are insanely flawed design to begin with, as the wheels mainly wear from one side. I personally can't understand why people defend it, because the main purpose of it is to increase companies' profit margins. And I don't know about you, but I like my printers being better and not inferior. However, the upgrade that can make your printer worse is the PI sheet on big beds. Yes, it is way more convenient to take off the prints and I prefer it over the glass, but if you won't have any bed leveling probe, the glass will get you a way flatter surface, which is extremely important for good first layer adhesion. Plus, weight is very similar, so you're not reducing much in that regard either. Moving for the upgrades, next is the bigger motor for the y-axis. This one was not needed even on an insane 2+ kg heat bed, because running that large amount of mass with high acceleration and jerk settings just doesn't make any sense longevity wise. If you're so obsessed with speed, just buy a CorxY machine. Even at a moderate acceleration, higher you print, the more quality will downgrade on thinner prints. You're moving the whole print back and forth after all. When I tested this, I honestly was surprised it even finished printing, because here we get full 150 mm per second print speeds on straights, and it just looks wrong to print something that long and that thin that fast on a bed slinger. But depending on the design, results will heavily vary. Moving upwards, we arrive at the printhead. Installing linear rail on this specific printer was a pain, as it uses non-regular extrusions with covered front faces. All rails that I used for this printer were inexpensive ones from the KGT store on AliExpress. They don't even specify what type they are, but every rail that I bought had no binding and wasn't too loose. I would say they are more than good enough for a machine like this. But if you are building an expensive one and chasing every bit of quality improvement, make sure to buy the correct ones. The whole printhead assembly here is based on a single 3mm aluminum plate that PCBWay manufactured with their CNC service and sponsored this video. Their support has been great to help make all these designs of mine, that gives me ability to provide proper testing for all of you, so huge thanks to them. The plate mounts on the MGN12C linear rail and it uses few printed parts with heat inserts to mount everything neatly in place. It is designed for the high flow Spider-V1 hotend, but it is also compatible with a Volcano. It uses a 20mm stepper motor and BMG dual gear extruder. I'm glad I spent a lot of time designing it, because the simplicity and accessibility are just great. And most important, it can be mounted on almost any printer with a regular 20x20 profile. Having a high flow hotend with overkill cooling on a large build plate printer is the way to go, because you will never have to worry about insufficient cooling when extruding a lot of plastic with bigger nozzles. And the most important, you always can run it at lower speeds. And from my testing, 50 by 20 fans give the best performance to noise ratio, which for me is one of the most important things on a printer. But what about the print quality that the new direct drive extruder on a linear rail can offer? Well, the thing is that even without pressure compensation in the firmware, the letters were crisper at all acceleration values compared to the previous Bowden setup. And when we take a glance what a fully tuned pressure advance can provide with different setups, we can see that the smaller and lighter Megas, which uses Bowden, is not even close quality-wise when it comes to printing smaller details. In my opinion, Bowden shouldn't even exist nowadays, because big print heads that are not orientated to cut down the weight can still easily do around 10k accelerations, so the motor and extruder weight on the print head is not an issue. Especially on bed slingers, where you are limited by the heatbed weight and the basic nature of moving the whole print back and forth in the first place. And as both Bowden on POM wheels and direct drive on rails are light enough for their respective motion system, we won't see an X-axis ghosting in our prints. Moving even higher on the Z-axis, one of the first mods that I made on this printer was the dual leadscrews, synchronized by a belt and driven with one motor. The more Z-hops you do and bigger prints you make, the more it is worth it. But it is one of the harder mods to make, so ideally next time buying a 3D printer, make sure that it has the dual Z-axis in the first place. But upgrades like POM nuts are way easier and they don't require any lubrication, plus has less friction than a lubricated brass nut. I tested that in the Teflon coat and lead screw video. You won't get print quality improvements, but no lubrication aspect is worth it on its own. So far all upgrades were mechanical. They offer print quality and quality of life improvements, but to take the most advantage of them, there is the only way. Better hardware control. That means Clipper. For this build, I used a newly released E3 Easy board that BictureTech sent for this project. With the board, you'll need the CB1 module that can be slotted very compactly into the main board. It is basically the Raspberry Pi that does all the calculations and control. Plus, easy to owner and drivers that slots in only one way to prevent incorrect installation and offer convenient stepper motor current control. And when you use Clipper for a while, the only thought that comes to mind is why you haven't tried it sooner. I have to say, it can be a rough start, especially the less tech-savvy person you are, but unlike reality with their pretty much useless manual on SonicPad, BictureTech here made it step by step so that almost everyone can do it by following it. I can't stress this enough how much difference this makes for a beginner. Well then, so you replaced the board and connected all the wires. You configured the printer, used the accelerometer to tune the input shaping and ran the pressure advance calibration. Here are the results compared to this printer's stock firmware with the same mechanical upgrades, acceleration and jerk settings, plus compared with stock printer configuration on POM wheels. I don't know what to say about these results rather than Clipper can make your prints flawless. If your printer has a stiff frame and a rigid motion system, the most improvement you'll get from the pressure advance. The letters of the print look crisp and not over extruded. It is mind-blowing how much control of a molten plastic you can have with a proper control. Meanwhile, the ghosting results are less impressive, but that is because we mostly eliminated them with a Y-axis linear rail upgrade. Plus, because we upgraded the whole main board, we get additional quality of life improvements like free fan speed control ports. You also have BL touch screen support, filament runout, RGB strip control, and many other features. When I tested the Sonic Pad, it made controlling a printer easy by just plugging in USB, but if your old motherboard doesn't have features you need, then it won't just magically appear. Even something simple like a fan shutdown when you're hot and is cold annoyed me the most. The only thing that I didn't like about the E3 Easy board is that the fan ports are only rated for 1 amp. I understand why such a small and tightly packed board has only a 10 amp heatbed rating and you need an additional module with big heatbeds to not destroy it, but I wished the limit was higher for the fans. So, with many tests done, my suggestion if you want to chase that perfect print quality is to start with Clipper, either by upgrading the whole board if your current one is crappy or using anything that can run Clipper. It is not beginner friendly way, but all the trouble can be worth it in the end. And if you have a printer with POM wheels on all axes, are these mechanical upgrades worth it? As much as I love designing, upgrading and testing things, at least cost-wise it makes very little sense. Especially when you can buy all-in a rod printer for such a low price and clipperize for not that much. Sure, it has weak print cooling, but it's only one and way smaller thing that you have to worry about. But if you want to have something with no compromises, you have to make upgrades yourself, or build something that is designed without profits in mind, like Warons. Because I highly doubt you will ever get a no compromise 3D printer from any profit driven company. There's always be a catch. If you enjoyed the video, make sure to give it a like. If you want to know more about most upgrades that I talked about, check out my previous videos. Also make sure you are following me on Twitter and Instagram, as I post a lot of useful information there. Thanks to everyone who supported or still supports my work on Patreon. That's all from me, and I will see you next time.